1 minute left, sir.
Oh, shall we start?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Shall I start, sir?
Yeah, you can invite madam to join. She's already joined. Okay. We can start.
Yeah, it's live on YouTube. We can start.
Okay.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My humble salutations to our distinguished guests and all the participants who have gathered virtually today. And greetings to the hosting committee and the faculty of University Law College and Department of Studies in Law, Bangalore University. I am Pooja, student of University Law College, Bangalore University, and it gives me immense pleasure to be the master of ceremony for this session. Today, after filling up ourselves with blessings and positive festive vibes post Ganesh Chaturthi, we, the ULC team, is back to host the 12th lecture of the ULC Special Lecture Series. And it's indeed an esteem to have with us Ms. Jaina, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India, and Executive Director, CLPR, who will be delivering a lecture regarding the harassment of women on social media. Before we move on, we have something to share about our esteemed college. The University Law College, Bangalore University, presently offers 5 years LLB Honours Program and 2 year LLM Program with 4 specialization branches. Our college has proud alumni, including the former Chief Justice of India, Honorable Justice M.N. Venkatachalaya, former Judge of the Supreme High Court, Honorable Justice N. Venkatachala, Honorable Justice N. Santosh Hegde, Honorable Justice R.V. Ravindran, and many other Chief Justices and Judges of the High Courts, former Chief Ministers, and many eminent law practitioners and academicians. It's indeed an honor to be a part of the ULC family. Now, I request our beloved Principal, Professor Dr. Suresh V. Nadagowdar, Principal University Law College, Bangalore University, to render the welcome address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Pooja. Good afternoon, everyone. Respected guest speaker of the day, Jaina Kothari, senior advocate and our proud alumni, our honorable vice chancellor. He will be joining us in the course of the lecture. Dr. V. Sudesh, former principal, Dr. Dasharath, chairman and dean faculty of law, Dr. N. Satish Gowda, Dr. Jyoti Vishwanath, Dr. Chandrakanti, and respected invitees, all their students. Indeed, we are very happy and privileged to have Srimati Jaina Kothari, who is a senior advocate at the Supreme Court and an illustrious alumni of University Law College. We are really very happy and thank you, madam, for accepting the invitation and gracing us today. And I, on behalf of Bangalore University and University Law College, I extend you a very warm welcome to this special lecture.
Thank you.
I also extend a warm welcome to our Honorable Vice Chancellor in his absence, as he is busy with another program and he will be joining us shortly. And I also extend a warm welcome to our esteemed colleagues, Professor Sudesh, Professor Dasharath, Dr. Satish, Jyoti, Dr. Chandrakanti, President and members of our Alumni Association, and all invitees and dear students to this program. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for extending a warm welcome to our guests and the participants for today. Before we get started, any questions on the lecture may please be posted to Mr. Satyajit, the co-host, and the YouTube viewers can post their questions in the comment section. We will take it up after the lecture during the question answer segment. Well, social media. It is one such tool which is widely used by the women today. Creating pages on networking sites, writing blogs, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, mails, etc., act as a platform for the women to communicate their new ideas or a chance to share what they feel and to fight against what is injustice according to them. But such hypothetical opportunities stand in stark contrast to experiences of harassment. Women in particular are harassed on social media because they happen to be women who dare to be public online. To analyze and discuss on this dynamic topic, we have with us an exemplary dignitary, Ms. Jaina Kothari. Ms. Jaina Kothari is a senior advocate and practices in the Supreme Court of India. She is a co-founder of Center for Law and Policy Research, a legal research organization dedicated to the defense of constitutional values in India. She graduated from University Law College with a BA LLB degree and secured a postgraduate Bachelor of Civil Laws degree at the University of Oxford, UK. She was awarded the Wrangler DC Pavage Fellowship in Cambridge University. Ms. Jaina's research and practice interests include constitutional law, gender and sexuality law, disability rights, discrimination law, administrative law, and intellectual property rights. She is also a recipient of the National Child Rights Fellowship 2010, awarded by the Child Rights and Youth. She had argued in the Supreme Court in the recent constitutional challenges to Section 377 and adultery, which were both decriminalized. She also argued the independent thought case in which the Supreme Court recognized also working by the TransCommunity. The Future of Disability Law in India was published in 2012 by the Oxford University Press. It's a standard reference guide to disability law in India. Ma'am, we are indeed honored to have you here and are eagerly waiting to hear your lecture. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Pooja, for the very kind introduction and welcome. Thank you, Professor Nadagowda, for inviting me and to the Vice Chancellor and other faculty members of ULC. It is really a special moment for me as an alumni of University Law College to come back and give this talk today. Although it's an online talk, since we're all now moving to online platforms, it is, in any event, a special moment for me. I think for any alumni to be called back to their alma mater, for their university, for their college to call them back, it is always a special moment. For me, my 5 years in ULC were indeed very, very special. This was where I did my law degree. This was where I decided to be a lawyer and to litigate for social causes. And ULC gave me that foundation. For which, you know, on the basis of which my practice has taken off. So I'll always be grateful to ULC, and so therefore thank you for calling me. Today we're going to discuss on harassment of women in social media, and how do we address that? You know, this is something that is becoming more and more rampant today. We're seeing that earlier we were talking about harassment of women on the streets, and you know, we had in the IPC laws on molestation, eve teasing, etc. Then we moved to harassment at the workplace, and we had the Vishakha guidelines, and we had the Prevention of Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Act. But now we are finding that there is more and more harassment, sexual harassment, threats of violence, and all other forms of harassment online and on social media. And we don't have legislation to deal with that. And so how do we deal with this kind of harassment? Do we have other laws which we can use? Does this kind of harassment pose new challenges? How do we understand this kind of harassment? So let me just, what I'll do is I'll speak for about, I've prepared something, and I'll speak for about 20 to 25 minutes, and then I'll open up this forum for questions, input, or any other comments. Okay. So, you know, when we talk about harassment online or on social media, what it brings to us is that social media is brings is like a double-edged sword, right? On one hand, social media gives you the freedom to express yourself and to, you know, express your thoughts, to write, to give your comments on what's happening. It provides very easily, it provides women especially who don't have the outlets to, you know, set up their organizations or, you know, marginalized groups who are not able to afford other forms of, you know, even for business or for any other forms of communication. Social media or online outlets are the most easiest way to disseminate one's work, one's practice, one's trade, one's opinions, etc. At the same time, while it is so easy to express one's views and opinions online on social media and the advantages that it brings, the, you know, on the other side is that it also opens up people to harassment, abuse, and violence in a way that is far more easier than in the real world. And that's because anyone can abuse you and harass you and even give you extremely violent threats completely under anonymity, because you can open up accounts anonymously. You don't have to reveal your name, identity, other details, and therefore it is as easy as it is to express one's views, it is that easy to abuse people as well. And therefore, social media does come as a double-edged sword. And often what happens is that women, especially women from marginalized backgrounds, are at a very, very high risk of harassment and threat on social media. Often we find that online violence that women experience is actually an extension of the offline violence, and there's quite a strong and causal link between these kinds of violence. What I mean by that is that the way, the manner in which, I mean, you know, social media violence or abuse online is a reflection of how women are viewed as objects of, you know, are viewed as sexual objects, and that is, you know, seen in the kind of death threats, the kind of rape threats, trolling, sexual harassment that women end up facing. And often you find that there is a link to physical violence as well. In many cases, women who have faced trolling online have also complained or kind of experienced the troll mobs or people coming to their residences, people coming to their colleges, coming to their workplaces and threatening them. So it's, I don't think we should take this casually to say that, okay, this is online abuse and just ignore it, it will go. Often it doesn't go. And the online violence and harassment is followed up by offline or real-time harassment and threats, and often real violence as well. The kind of online harassment that women end up facing are threats, violence, violent threats, bullying. It's called cyberbullying when it is done online. There is cyber stalking, where women are stalked online. There's misuse of their photos and identities, and this is often known in the language of doxing. You know, this is also known as doxing, where your identity is misused. So all these are different forms of online harassment that women face. And, you know, we have seen this happening to some extent, not just, you know, of course, there are completely unknown girls and women who face it for just innocent comments that they may make on their social Facebook or Twitter account. But there are even extremely well-known personalities who have been at the receiving end of social media trolling and harassment. The journalist Barkhadat, journalist Rana Ayub, for their comments have been trolled and faced vicious death threats to such an extent that they've had to, you know, file police complaints. There have been, you know, actresses and celebrities. Swara Bhaskar is one example, who has not only faced a lot of online trolling, but, you know, there has even been, I think, a contempt petition filed, seeking permission to file criminal contempt against her. So, you know, this is not limited to just, you know, women who are both celebrities or not very well-known women have faced a lot of harassment. A recent, and you know, what is interesting is that online violence experienced by women is just increasing. In fact, the data shows that the Karnataka State Women's Commission actually reported that in 2019, 60% of the complaints of harassment that the commission received from women were about online harassment. So we're seeing that actually complaints of online harassment are more than complaints of, you know, real time or regular offline harassment. Amnesty International conducted a recent study where it showed that they conducted a detailed survey, and they showed that 70% of the women they surveyed had said that they faced some kind of online harassment or the other. And most of these studies show that even from the women who face harassment online, it's more women who are from marginalized groups. So they would be women from Dalit or Adivasi backgrounds, trans women, women from, women from LGBTQI groups, women from religious minorities. So basically, it's more of marginalized women who face more harassment. Now, with this kind of a situation where there is so much online abuse and harassment, how does our law deal with it? Do we have adequate legal protection that addresses such forms of harassment? And let me now kind of try and cover some of the legislations that are there and analyze whether they can be used to address some of these situations. So looking at harassment, we have, of course, the Prevention of Sexual Harassment at the Workplace Act. This was a law enacted in 2013 and enacted mainly to address sexual harassment at work, to both to prevent it and to address it. Now, this law, most commonly known as the POSH Act, this mainly applies to any kind of sexual harassment at work. It defines sexual harassment as any unwelcome acts or behavior. It could be verbal, non-verbal, so definitely it could be written acts. And this is conduct that is unwelcome. So clearly the woman has not wanted it or not instigated it. This is conduct which is of a sexual nature. It includes making sexually colored remarks. So all of this would definitely come under sexual harassment under the definition in the POSH Act. But the POSH Act has one limit. So that limitation is that it is any kind of sexual harassment that is related to the workplace. Now, workplace, the definition of workplace is also quite wide. Workplace, it would include any place where the woman is working. It includes, even in the definition of the act, even a dwelling house or a home. Now, today, with the COVID pandemic, where most people are working from home, if you're working online and you are at home, then you are at your workplace. You know, your home is your workplace because you're working from home. And if you face any harassment online during your work, it would certainly come under the POSH Act, and you can file a complaint. The employer has an obligation of setting up an internal complaints committee and address it as per the guidelines given under the law. Now, of course, not all kinds of online harassment would come under it, even if you're working at home. So, for example, if there is You know, if you make a comment on Twitter, which is made in your personal capacity, and a woman faces, you know, a particular woman faces a lot of trolls and gets abusive threats from random strangers for her comments, that would not come under workplace sexual harassment under the POSH Act. But there could be other kinds of social media harassment which would come under it. So let me give you an example. You know, I often sit in as an external member on internal complaints committees at several organizations as required under the POSH Act. One complaint we received was from a young woman who had recently joined this organization. She was a new, she had just recently been employed there. And at her workplace, she met one of her colleagues or co-workers. And he was showing a lot of interest in her. She clearly, you know, she made it clear to him that she was not interested. And she was maintaining her distance as a colleague. He then started stalking her online on her Facebook account. And so, you know, she would put up, say, photographs of herself with her friends or, you know, personal photographs on her Facebook social media account. He would constantly be, you know, commenting on them. Some of those comments made her quite uncomfortable. He would constantly message her online. He would message her on her social media accounts. He would send her comments and messages which clearly had a sexual content and were of a sexual nature. So this made her extremely uncomfortable, and it was almost like stalking. Like, she felt that he was constantly stalking her and stalking her whereabouts. And she then filed a complaint of sexual harassment at work. So, you know, this can be an example where online stalking can be an incident of workplace harassment. And in those instances, we can use the POSH Act. But there are other situations where it's not directly related only to one's work. And in such cases, there are other provisions of criminal law. You have provisions under the IPC and other related legislations, which can then be used for any other kind of online harassment. And some of the criminal law amendments were made, you know, on this, you know, in 2013 after the Nirbhaya case. There was a wide range of criminal law reforms that were brought about. In fact, the POSH Act was also brought about at that time in 2013. At the same time, there were a whole range of criminal law reforms brought about. The IPC was amended substantively to include more offenses relating to women. And some of the offenses that were introduced into the IPC were Section 354A, which in fact addresses sexual harassment in the IPC, and that's not related to work. So it could be sexual harassment anywhere, and this would definitely include online forms of harassment. There's 354D and 354C, which include stalking, which are the offenses of stalking and voyeurism. So those sections are also there. For example, stalking is any online stalking. Voyeurism would be the offense where a victim's capture of any images are disseminated to third persons without permission. So, you know, any kind of use of images without consent and sharing them on social media, all of that also is a criminal offense of voyeurism. I think a lot of you may have read about last month or maybe a couple of months ago during the lockdown period, there was an incident in Delhi where a group of boys, high school boys, had started an Instagram group where they were disseminating, they were disseminating images of their female classmates and also talking, you know, giving a lot of rape threats on the Instagram group. So definitely all of that would come under the offenses of 354A and D, C and D. There are also the offenses of outraging the modesty of a woman, which is also there. I mean, it's an outdated offense, but it is still there. So all of those criminal law offenses under the IPC are certainly there and can be used. Though they don't specifically talk about online abuse, all this harassment is not limited in any way. So it certainly can be used. What you can also use is another legislation, which is the Information Technology Act. So the IT Act has certain provisions which also can be used in the case of online abuse or online harassment. Section 66E is there. Of course, we have Section 66A, which has been set aside by the Supreme Court in the Shreya Singhal case. But Section 66E says that whoever intentionally or knowingly captures, publishes, or transmits the image of a private area of any person without his or her consent under the circumstances violating the privacy of that person shall be punished. So any circulation of images, non-consensual circulation of images of a person under Section 66E would also be an offense. So, you know, we do have all these, legislations which can be used, which can be addressed for online abuse and harassment. So, but you know, what I think we need to realize is that not only is the online harassment faced by women a form of sexual harassment, which is covered in some of these legislations, it's sexual harassment, stalking, voyeurism, and all of these acts, but it is also a violation of a woman's right to privacy when her details are exposed. You know, doxing includes, doxing is a term used for online abuse where a woman's, where a person's personal details are shared, like phone number, addresses, etc. And, you know, all of this is a serious violation of a woman's right to privacy. And in the recent judgment in the Puttaswamy case on the right to privacy, the Supreme Court clearly held that the right to privacy is three-dimensional. It includes personal autonomy, it includes bodily integrity, and it includes privacy to one's personal information or informational privacy. And if you look at some of these acts, they are clearly a violation of a woman's right to privacy. It is also the threats and abuse and trolling that happens online is also a way of ensuring that women's right to free speech is curbed and censored. So it leads to a chilling effect on one's right to free speech. You know, if you see women being trolled and harassed for voicing their opinions online, other women will be too afraid to make such strong opinions, to express such strong opinions online. And that is also the purpose of online abuse or harassment. Now, so these are constitutional rights violations as well, and not just criminal law offenses. So how do we address this, and the current legislation do we have, is that enough and is that adequate to deal with such forms of harassment? I would strongly argue that it's not. It's not enough that we just have some of these criminal law remedies or that we have the IT Act, because these provisions are not sufficient to cover the extent of harassment that one experiences in the online world. And I would argue that we do need a specific legislation that covers that covers the internet and that covers harassment and abuse on the internet in a very holistic way. And in this regard, I'd like to just outline a few things. There was a recent judgment of the Kerala High Court where there was a case of severe online harassment and troll, where threats were given to a woman. And in this case, where the person sought bail, anticipatory bail, in I mean, though it was a decision, a judgment on whether bail should be granted or not, for the first time, the High Court, I mean, any High Court, went into this issue of online sexual harassment. And the Kerala High Court observed that such forms of offensive remarks and threats that were made by the accused to this woman on her social media account, this constitutes online sexual harassment. And this is the first time that a High Court has recognized that what happens online is also sexual harassment. And I think that's an important step forward. The ministry, the government has taken some steps. They've opened helplines that you can, you know, call up, etc., to address such forms of online harassment. But I don't think just helplines, etc., are enough. If you're recognizing sexual harassment online, then we do need legislation to ensure that it's addressed from all angles. So, for example, one major issue that arises is what is the role of social media intermediaries, companies like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, on whose platforms such threats or harassment takes place. So when death threats, rape threats are posted online on Twitter, does Twitter have any obligation or not? Can Twitter just say, well, we are not responsible for this because, we just provide a free platform for everyone to, express their views. Now, while it may on one hand sound reasonable, but when you see the amount of violence, the amount of prejudiced remarks, the amount of hate speech that is going on, and and the serious impact it has on a person's life and safety, I don't think we can take the view that intermediaries like Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, or any other online platform don't have any responsibility. We've seen in the US when President Donald Trump made very offensive remarks concerning the Black Lives Movement, and certain remarks were clearly prejudiced. Twitter did block some of his remarks. So there is a wider movement arising where a claim is made that intermediaries should be held accountable, and they should have a legal obligation on them to ensure that offensive remarks, harassing remarks, should be removed, and they should have internal mechanisms to ensure that those remarks and threats are not allowed on their platforms. Now, we don't have a legislation that imposes any obligations on intermediaries. Not only that, how do you ensure that in some cases where there are serious claims of serious threats of abuse, including threats of physical harm, etc., how do we trace the identity of the harasser, even if the police has to take any action? So there are obligations on intermediaries to reveal such details as well. So we do need, I think, a specific law that would address online abuse in a more detailed way. So, for example, there are examples of such legislations in other jurisdictions. The UK has the UK Communications Act, which addresses sexual harassment online against women, and it talks about, it imposes obligations if there is any improper use of a communications network, which can be invoked in cases of cyber stalking or cyber harassment. So I think we need to look at some of these other legislations, look at either amending our IT Act to include certain measures like this, or having a separate law that looks at our conduct online, especially abuse and harassment and proliferation of hate speech online, whether it's against women or against anyone else. I don't think we can today say that this is just on social media, so we should let it go. As we're seeing during the pandemic, our lives are more and more kind of spent online and on social media. So unless we regulate social media, unless we ensure that women are safe on social media, I don't think we can say that what we have, the legislation that we have, is enough, because our current legislation does not address the safety of women online. Thank you.
So thank you very much, madam, for your very informative and enlightening lecture on a very important topic of harassment of women on social media. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. That was so informative and enlightening. Ma'am, with your permission, shall we take a few questions posted by our audience?
Sure.
Yeah. So now we move on to the next segment, that is the question answer part of the session. The first question is from Mr. Vikrant, and his question goes like this. Ma'am, what is the role of social media platforms in having policies and mechanisms to prevent harassment of women? Ma'am?
Yeah. So I think it's an important question. The role of social media platforms is extremely important in preventing harassment. And that's what I kind of tried to say towards the end of my session. Social media platforms like Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, or any other platforms, they have an important role to play. They have to have internal policies that will ensure that they will actually review comments, they will review material that is put up on their platforms, and where the material is offensive, it is violent, it is abusive, they have to take steps to actually prevent such material from being put up on their platforms. Now, many of these social media platforms have internal policies, but we don't know whether all of them have such policies. If they do have such policies, whether they're implementing those policies effectively. But, you know, there's no legal obligation on them to have such policies. And there is right now no legal obligation on them that if their platform has, abusive, threatening, violent material put up, then what is their role? So that's why I think that it's very important that we have legislation which imposes such obligations on social media platforms, that they have to review everything and take steps to take it down where it is clearly a form of harassment.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Ms. Panchami. Her question goes like this, ma'am. What is your opinion on vicious social media trials and the deliberate witch hunting without any valid proofs? Is there any action that a woman can take because of the mental trauma that she undergoes due to the excessive trolling and harassment?
Thanks. This is one of the dangers of social media, that on any issue there is, it's like a trial by media, and here it is trial by social media, the danger with social media trials is that it becomes, it is open to anybody. People can be completely anonymous, have anonymous accounts, and say whatever they want. And there is no accountability. At least on trial in electronic media or the print media, there is some accountability. But in social media, there's absolutely no accountability. Anyone can say what they want. So we are seeing that, in any situation, even when you talk about the recent Sushant Singh suicide, there is a complete trial going on in social media, on how he committed suicide or whether it was anything suspicious, and allegations are made on women, his former girlfriend, etc., to such an extent that she needed protection. Now, these The kind of mental harassment trauma that women end up facing is, I mean, there is, it is unimaginable. You know, the kind of death threats and violent threats we see online is just, though they may not be carried out, and in some cases they are actually being carried out, it is so abusive and, you know, induces so much fear that we have instances where women have been, you know, because of this, these kind of social media trials, they have been thrown out of their jobs. They've had to move, they've had to leave their locality because in the neighborhood also everybody knows who this woman is because of the social media kind of wrong publicity given to her. They've had to move cities, they have to go to another place. Their entire lives have been turned upside down because of the vicious social media trials. And yes, I think they deserve compensation, but the question is from whom will they ask for compensation? Often the social media trials and harassment is by an unknown mob, right? There are groups of anonymous persons who are trolling you and giving you these death threats. So who are you going to claim compensation from? Can you claim compensation from the social media platform for exposing you to this? These are some things to think about.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question is, since social media platforms operate beyond borders, how can law enforcement authorities deal with offenses which are cross-border in nature? As in, if the person who harasses is not a resident within the territory of India, how can a victim in India take a legal recourse?
Yeah, this is an interesting question. And this is one of the risks and dangers of social media, right? That you can have anybody from anywhere harassing you or threatening you. What I think we need to, I mean, there are two ways I can answer it. One is that there has to be some liability on the platform, on the social media platform. And if there is liability on the social media platform, those platforms do have domestic or national offices. So for example, Facebook has Facebook India. So you definitely can seek some action or some accountability from Facebook India or the Twitter India office. So that you can do. And where the identity of persons who are the harassers and there are criminal actions that could be taken and the identity of the person is revealed or is known, and that person, the individual or individuals, are beyond the borders of India, then of course our criminal law has, you know, we do have the legal processes to, you know, initiate criminal action, to extradite the offender and take all those steps. I mean, we've done that in case of other offenses, right? Where smugglers or other offenders have gone beyond the borders of our country. So we can do that. But the difficulty mainly is that in the cases of online harassment, you often don't know the identity of the persons. So in those situations, I think we have to find, we have to look at law reform which holds at least the social media platforms accountable to some extent.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is from Mr. Arzalan Zaidi. He says, ma'am, considering what you have said, can we say that the implementation of the existing law is inadequate? If yes, how can we ensure proper implementation of a new set of laws to examine this? Also, what is the role of judiciary in addressing this problem?
Yeah, thank you. I think this is a useful question. Yes, existing laws are not being implemented adequately. And I'll just give you an example. Today, you know, we have the cyber police stations, right? So whenever we have any complaints under the IT Act, you have to go to the cyber police station. Now going there, you know, registering a complaint, how many cases have we ourselves seen where someone who has complained of cyberbullying or cyber stalking or harassment has led to any conviction. You know, even in a small case where the identity of the person is clearly known. I mean, you know, I get so many cases where, for example, these are very simple cases where a woman will complain to me saying that her photographs, her images, which she had have somehow been shared and put up on a social media account. Now, it is not difficult to trace who that person is. It can definitely, the police, the cyber police can do it through the social media platform and taking, you know, through a police warrant, they can definitely get the information or an identity of the person who has posted this. But even in these simple cases, there is no action taken, conviction is not there, and, you know, we don't see that criminal action is swift and strong and fast. So, and in these cases, the action by the authorities have to be very fast, because today in social media, one image or one thing can be shared multiple number of times in an hour. So the damage to a person's reputation or the harassment faced by her, unless you nip it in the bud immediately, it's of no use. And we see that it's not being done. I mean, you know, even if you talk about the heinous forms of threats and harassment by even these, you know, well-known journalists and celebrities, what has happened in their cases? Has anyone been arrested? Has any fine or liability been imposed on social media platforms? Nothing. So one issue is, yes, our existing, even the IT Act, you know, is not really implemented strongly in such cases, especially when women go and complain of harassment. Often the response when a woman goes and complains of harassment, the response is the same kind of response where a woman goes and complains about harassment in a regular case, saying that, oh, you only must have encouraged this. You must have been dating this fellow. You must have put up your photos online. Why did you do this? What were you wearing? So, you know, the allegations are put back again on the woman and her character when she goes to complain about any online form of abuse. So, yes, this our current implementation of the law is not at all adequate. We see that even in the judiciary, a recognition of this is not there. Of course, we had one good case of the Kerala High Court, but you know, even in our Karnataka High Court and other cases, we find that the judiciary also is not that alive to it. We find so many cases even of where complaints of rape are made by women, and when they oppose bail to the accused, the judges often make comments which are very derogatory to women. Implying that the woman's character is not good. Now that, so, you know, we have to change that mindset, not just in the judiciary, in the police, in the enforcement authorities, so that these existing laws are, you know, implementation is strengthened. But definitely, I think we need additional laws that would address it. Yes, the challenge is that we may have many laws, but our laws may not be effectively implemented. So we have a double-edged challenge. How do we ensure that we have good laws? And how do we ensure that if we have good laws, they are also implemented properly?
Thank you, ma'am. I would now like to acknowledge the presence of the very simple and humble man, Professor Dr. K.R. Venugopal, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Bangalore University, and patron for today's lecture. Sir is a well-known academician who has a distinguished academic career with 11 degrees, including 2 PhDs. We welcome you, sir.
Hearty welcome to you, sir.
Namaste, namaste,
today,
sir.
Madam Jaina Kotari. She's a
Jaina
senior,
Kotari, we are very happy.
Advocate and our own alumni, sir.
Yeah. Our own alumni. So which year, madam?
I passed out, sir, in 99.
Oh.
I graduated in 99.
Okay. 99. That, I did my law in 1984.
Oh, okay, okay. So I'm much younger than you.
Then
I was in the 94 batch, 94 to 99. I graduated in 99.
Hmm. Good. So I think Coutinho was the principal at
yes.
that time.
Yes, Dr. Coutinho was the principal and we were in the old campus.
Latika was there.
Yes. Yeah, Professor Latikanath was there, Dr. Coutinho, Dr. Yeah. Hanumant Rayappa.
Professor yeah. Sudesh also.
Yes, he yeah. was also there. He taught us yeah, in our final year, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm very, we have come to the end of the program?
Yeah, sir. Question okay. answer session is also over.
Oh, everything.
Now we are waiting for your remarks.
Yeah. I'm not in the area of activities. This, whatever has been addressed now, but I'm very happy that I'm participating in this program and we are with the eminent senior advocate, Jayana Kothari, our own alumni of Bangalore University. In fact, the Department of Law or University Law College is doing very well. I think this is the 12th or 13th lecture Special series, lecture. Which I'm, this is the 13th, I think, if I remember.
Yes, sir.
13th?
Yes, sir.
13th. And we have our chairman, Dashrath and Sudesh, then Satish Gowda, Jyoti Vishwanath and Chandrakanti, all the six teachers are doing extremely well. And as of now, we are even trying to get an auditorium, Allampally Venkatram chair, to the Department of Law or University Law College for Skill and Labor Institute, for establishing a Labor and Skill Institute. And we require a number of people. It is the alumni who contribute a lot. Even if you go to countries, other developed countries, alumni take a very active role, both in teaching as well as in funding some of the programs in the institution. And once as now we are with this online platform, now I think we are getting used to our alumni. There are so many programs we see that our alumni come and then really, try to enlighten whatever they have learned, their experience has been shared to the students. And that's very important. It was like a world Gurukula system where there was no communication, connectivity was not there and communication was very little. And whatever the teacher said, and that was final. But now you have come to a stage, you can talk from anywhere, anytime, any device with anyone. And that is the problem with the social media now. The social media harassment is that you talk to somebody and you do not know to whom you're talking. You fix a marriage, you get married online, and then you'll say, this is my husband, that is my husband, that is my wife. And then finally you'll say, I do not know. So you're all in a virtual world. In a virtual world, it becomes very difficult. So as it is, we are finding so many difficulties in the real world. So you can imagine this virtual plus real combined together, it possesses great hazards for daily life as well as it complicates the matter, especially with respect to law. You see people, when they commit a murder, they come into the court and then you see them that they are let off. And now that is a real situation. Now you are seeing a virtual situation, which is much more difficult to prove. I can always put a person's head and the body combined together and then I can collate it and then I can say something is somebody else. So we have seen most of the, even actress, their body and their limb and their everything is now collaged. And then you'll see that person is involved. Now you go to a court and the court says, okay, find out whether this image is real or virtual. Then you come to find out and you separate all the parts of the body and then you'll say, okay, this is not what it is. That is one I'm telling just with respect to one image. Then you come to the voice. When you come to the voice, you will tell, I can morph your voice. I can also, make a multiple copy of your voice and I can, always insert something else, signals, and it is very difficult now to even separate signals. But of course, technology has improved it to such an extent that you can also see what has been incorporated, what has been integrated. But the most important thing is it is becoming much more complex than the real-time situation where you have seen on when you see a real-time situation, say about 10 years back or 20 years back. So now you have come to a world where you have to say whether this can be accepted as evidence, whether this can be accepted as a photo which you have present put on the whether you have put whether whatever you put on your social media, is that the correct photo or is it your own photo? So all these things of things have come, and that has led to cyber crime, sexual harassment, and how do you integrate them to really address the problems? Now the most important thing that actually plagues the society is gender bias. When you come to a gender bias, when the judge is sitting on the other side, if he is a male person, he is towards him. If it is a female judge, it is another version. So you can both type of harassment can take place. Sexual harassment is not only for women, it is also for men equally, and it will become almost like equal in years to come, especially with the advent of cybercrime. So coming specifically to sexual harassment women on social media, women have always been considered as an inferior thing in this world, but not in Hinduism. Hinduism, we always upheld this status of women in the society. Otherwise, they would have been Swayamvara. Swayamvara was not there anywhere in the world. It was only practiced in this country because we respected women. But ultimately, over time, the women came to be disrespected because of its economic status. Why women were to be held in high status was that this country was prospering economically. It was in a very high state. The civilization was much advanced than any other civilization in this world. And therefore, the status of women was very high. And as we deteriorated in our economy and as we entered into slavery, the status of women also deteriorated in this country. And therefore, we see the harassment of women and the treatment of women as an object has taken an proportion which is larger than life. That's what we have seen today. Secondly, the enforcement authority is the law. The law is there. The law is not biased. The law is fair. But how do you use that law? How do you use that law to a person so that you give a fair judgment? That has been an issue in the present situation. And I can keep on talking like this, but I have picked up few jargons in law and a few jargons in when people speak, other people speak, and then I've been chilling, and that may not really make sense because I may not go beyond this granularity. I can only say, okay, I know only a peripheral thing of what is happening, but I feel the future is still, we have a lot of challenges in future, especially with the bandwidth that is available. Bandwidth is going to change the phenomena because when bandwidth increases, more of pornography, child pornography, then the morphing of images, making the fake images into real, and making the fake voice into real, all these problems will be entangling in the years to come. I do not want to take much of your time, but I'm very happy that Jaina Kothari is with us, and we are very happy, madam, that you are there and you have delivered a wonderful lecture to the benefit of our students. And I congratulate the University Law College for his endeavors and embarking upon such type of journey. And Bangalore University has become one of the foremost in online education over the last 3 months. Change. We always resist to change. And even in sexual harassment on social media, is that we have to look into, we have to formulate new laws, and we have to formulate laws for the present setting. And that's what the law department and the judiciary has to think of. The present laws are inadequate to protect actually women on social media. And that is my take. And thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to deliver this, presidential address. Pooja Gowda has been, I've seen the students of law have been overactivated now. And so they have already become like almost equivalent to teachers here. So that type of confidence has been generated in them. Thank you much. Thank you all for giving me an opportunity.
Thank you very much, sir. I'd like
to see you in the next lecture, and I will participate in the next lecture series.
Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable remarks. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for our support system. And yes, you are the source of inspiration behind all our successful events. Thank you so much.
Because of my computer science background and having taught the computer science, and I've been teaching computer science for last 41 years, I have forced this online platform for all the students and teachers of Bangalore University.
Yes,
and now they are very happy.
Definitely.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for answering all the questions patiently and providing your reviews and critical analysis. I'm sure the participants must have learned a lot from this session.
Thank you for inviting me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, there will be a formal vote of thanks or how?
Thank
sir,
you,
we announce the next lecture.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, kindly pay attention. Now, on behalf of University Law College, Bangalore University, I consider it my proud privilege to announce the next lecture in the ULC Special Lecture Series. We will be having with us the very eminent and an exceptional personality, Sri Udaya Hulla, Senior Advocate and former Advocate General, Karnataka, who will be delivering the lecture on the topic IPR regime in India on 26th August 2020 at 6 p.m. in the Zoom meeting app, as well as we will be live streaming on the YouTube. Further details will be shared soon. So do tune in for this next lecture as well. Dear audience, the feedback form has been posted in the chat box. Kindly fill in the same. Now, as we come to the end of today's session, I extend a hearty gratitude to all the dignitaries of this session. And now I request Ms. Harshita, student, University Law College, Bangalore University, to propose the vote of thanks. Over to you.
Before that, I have a small announcement. All those applicants who have applied for seeking admission to our University Law College, we would like to give some instructions. Kindly stay back with us after the program because we are going to have online admission process on 26th, sir. So we want to clarify their doubts and all now only.
Okay. Thank you. Shall I leave?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
So, or you can wait for a minute, sir. They will be offering a formal vote of thanks.
Okay, okay. No, I thought it is over.
No, it is there, sir, still.
Okay. Who is that, Harshita?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. A very good evening to the virtual gathering present here. I, Harshita, on behalf of University Law College and Department of Studies in Law, Bangalore University, deem it my honor and privilege to render the vote of thanks. First and foremost, I would like to express my profound gratitude to our special guest, Ms. Jayana Kothari, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India and Executive Director of CLPR, who despite her busy schedule, took time to deliver a special lecture on the issue harassment of women on social media in ULC Special Lecture Series and enlightening all of us with an extremely insightful session. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to our patron of the event, Professor Dr. K.R. Venugopal, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Bangalore University, for gracing this event and providing his constant support and guidance to all our endeavors. Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to thank Professor Dr. Suresh V. Nadigauda, Honorable Principal, University Law College, Bangalore University, for his constant support and guidance. I would also like to thank Professor Dr. N. Dashrath, Honorable Chairman, Department of Studies in Law, Dean Faculty of Law, Bangalore University, for his guidance. I thank all the faculty members for their constant support and encouragement in every step of the way. I would like to thank the Student Organizing Committee for their diligent efforts in putting up a marvelous event and congratulate them for the success of this event. I would like to thank and extend a heartfelt welcome to all the students and participants in the lecture series for turning up in a huge number and making this a grand success. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Harshita. And with this, we conclude today's session. I oblige University Law College and Department of Studies in Law, Bangalore University, for giving me an opportunity to host this session. Thank you, one and all. Have a pleasant evening. Jai.